opportunity to see a lot of my seniors, met Dr. Prashad, who was the head of the department when I was doing MD in KGMC. And the topic that I've been asked to talk about is bronchoscopy in the ICU. And most of us that are sitting here and have patients, deal with acute care patients, would at some point either have decided to do it ourselves or have asked for a bronchoscopy. And I'm going to be talking a little bit about physiology, a little bit about indications and the contraindications, and also what are the advances that we see in the role of bronchoscopy in the ICU. So when we talk about, I've divided it into all these points that we talked about. Before we start, this is one study which came out in CHEST in 2000, which basically showed us that bronchoscopy is not just shoving a little scope down endotracheal tube in an intubated patient. It does a lot of things to the pulmonary system in an already compromised pulmonary system when the patient is in the ICU. And this bench study basically showed that there is extremely low tidal volume and a very high autopeep generated whenever you push a scope down into an endotracheal tube or an intubated patient who is on the ventilator. And a very high flow is generated. And when you compare it between whether it is the pressure control mode or the volume control mode, both will cause physiological changes in the compromised lung, but somewhere down the line the study showed that pressure control ventilation is probably better when you're trying to do a bronchoscopy for the patient. Above all, what I want you to take away from this busy slide is that when you're doing bronchoscopy, the scope that you use should be 2 millimeters less than what should be the size of your endotracheal tube. So the standard endotracheal tube, which you should be asking for before doing a bronchoscopy with a standard bronchoscope, should be 8 to 8.5 centimeters. Anything less than that, you don't have enough space to negotiate your scope, and you're actually playing around with the physiology even more. And if you look at this slide, this clearly shows you that presence of a bronchoscope in the airways basically decreases not only the PO2, it increases the PaCO2, as shown in these studies. And as you can see, that these alterations are magnified along much, much more when you're suctioning. And when you're suctioning, you actually take away 200 to 300 ml of the patient's tidal volume. You reduce it straight away as soon as you're suctioning, not just because of the fluid itself, but because of the suction force that is caused when you put the scope right in. And the gas exchange modifications that you see when bronchoscopy is being done, the suggested mechanisms that have been shown say that there is reduction in the expired tidal volume in these patients, and this is prominently even more during suction, to the tune of 200 to 300 ml, which is huge, especially if you're doing a bronchoscopy in a patient with ARDS, where a patient's PEEP is about 10 or 12. And there, you're just going in, you're losing the PEEP, on top of that, you're suctioning and losing even more tidal volume. Therefore, but having said that, sometimes there can be improvement in oxygenation as well. And where do you see it? That is usually where patients present with atelectasis, where there is mucus plugging, where there is a blood clot, and you remove it and you find significant improvement. Therefore, trying to know which patient you're doing it for and what you should be expecting is significantly important. And to finish our physiology, this is our last slide, where you can see that the PaCO2 increases, the PO2 decreases, there's an increase in cardiac output in most of these patients when you are doing your bronchoscopy. And these are to be kept in mind when you're doing a bronchoscopy on a patient who doesn't only have respiratory failure but also has heart failure, because you might worsen their heart failure even more while doing it, and you need to keep those things in mind. Now, coming to indications for bronchoscopy, that is the second point that we were going to discuss. You can divide it safely into the diagnostic and therapeutic. And diagnostic is what we use bronchoscopy maximally for in most of our ICUs. And when we say diagnostic, it can be for diagnosis of a ventilator-associated pneumonia or infection, when diagnosing it early. And pneumonia, respiratory failure due to non-infectious lung diseases, is the second diagnostic point that you need to find out. Whether a patient has had any airway trauma or not when you're intubating the patient, whether there has been any airway trauma or not. Trying to verify if your endotracheal tube is in place or not is what you need to find out. If a patient has hemoptysis, what is the cause of hemoptysis? You can use it to verify that or not. And also, after you have taken the endotracheal tube out, if there is a wheeze and you want to find out if the patient has had some laryngeal or tracheal trauma, you can still use the bronchoscope to diagnose that. Therapeutically, primarily, it's for airway clearing, airway suctioning and airway toileting. Very, very, very important, because these patients are not able to take out their secretions, especially patients with chronic bronchitis, bronchiectasis, etc., have very viscid secretions which they are not able to clear out, and that causes significant amount of decrease in tidal volume and ventilatory problems in these patients, and clearing it out actually helps ventilatory recovery much more. So therefore, airway management is significantly important. Atelectasis, hemoptysis, clearing hemoptysis out, and specifically foreign bodies when you're suspecting them. Also, fibrin glue therapy, which I will touch upon slightly. This is a picture that you see mostly, and you ask for a bronchoscopy in a ventilated patient where there is a ventilator-associated pneumonia. And the preamble is, most of the times we have to treat empirically until we get a culture report back. So you either treat empirically or you get a diagnosis back. So lots of times it has been discussed where bronchoscopies are not available, where just an endotracheal suctioning or a mini BAL is good enough or not. Many studies have shown that mini BAL is good enough, but a BAL where it is done in an immunocompromised patient gives you much more information. And not only does it give you much more information, there are various techniques. Ever since we started training, I was taught that protected specimen brush should be sent. But this study, the reason I brought it here, has shown that a bronchoalveolar lavage is as good, if not better. If actually it's better than protective specimen brushing, you don't really need to do protective specimen brushing. Bronchoalveolar lavage is good enough, because when you brush an inflamed airway, it oozes. It oozes for a much longer time. Therefore, suctioning it and washing it alone is good enough rather than going in and brushing it. So BAL is good enough. Also, when you're looking for, you know, non-infectious causes of pneumonia, such as an ARDS, there is now more and more studies going on about proteomics and metabolomics, going in, getting the fluid from the infected or affected areas and sending it off for proteomics. There's a lot of studies going on, and within the next 4 or 5 years, somebody here will be standing and talking about proteomics in ARDS patients and how BAL can actually predict whether ARDS is going to get better or not. We used to talk about fibroproliferative phases of ARDS, but trying to find out how quickly a patient is going to get better, or where you can actually intervene and make ARDS better by proteomics, is a line which is going to be talked about very soon. The next thing that I want to talk about is infectious diseases, and that is what we, as I just mentioned, in ARDS, the BAL fluid analysis and the BAL white cell differential count can sometimes help in distinguishing structures that mimic infection, and some of them are actually treatable. The BAL fluid and cell count analysis are currently a potent research tool for proteomics and ARDS, as I just said, especially acute lung injury and in chemical lung injuries, which is seen more abroad rather than in our country, because by the time the patient comes to us, it's quite a few days since they've had it. Conditions that mimic or cause acute respiratory distress syndrome most commonly are pneumonias, and amongst pneumonias in our country, especially miliary tuberculosis is something that is very, very common. Please remember, in miliary tuberculosis and bronchoalveolar lavage, you might not get any AFB whatsoever. But if you combine bronchoalveolar lavage with endobronchial and transbronchial lung biopsies, then the chances of getting your diagnosis of tuberculosis is very high. I have a patient from this city alone who presented with hemophagocytic syndrome, but no diagnosis, had had a bronchoscopy before. But the only way we diagnosed it this time, when he went on the ventilator with that sick condition, was doing some endobronchial biopsies, which basically showed us caseating granulomas, and we treated the patient for TB. Similarly, other viruses such as cytomegalovirus, pneumocystis carinii, fungal pneumonia, especially in patients who are receiving chemotherapy or are immunosuppressed due to other causes, can also present with ARDS-like picture. And bronchoscopic lavage can actually help you, especially in CMV, guide you with the titers and also how much infection there is. Other non-infective causes can be cryptogenic organizing pneumonia, acute interstitial pneumonias, and acute eosinophilic pneumonia. Especially in acute eosinophilic pneumonia, it actually helps significantly by doing a bronchoalveolar lavage and finding a high level of eosinophils in your bronchoalveolar lavage fluid. Other things that you can diagnose are malignancy, especially bronchoalveolar cell carcinoma, and the central bronchial tumors such as small cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma, etc., can be diagnosed. The other thing that is quite useful in is sometimes when you have to do a double lumen tracheal tube intubation, you definitely need a bronchoscope. Or you find somebody with a short neck and are not able to intubate them, you use your bronchoscope to intubate the patient and also to find whether it is landed safely in place or not. For example, in a patient like this who had severe pneumonia on one side and significantly high ventilated lung on the opposite side, when you look down with your bronchoscope, you find that the ET tube is actually significantly on the diseased side rather than the other side. And there you can pull it back up. So post-extubation, as I said, you can, if a patient presents with stridor in the intensive care unit, you can put your bronchoscope down to see whether there is laryngeal edema, whether there is any other evidence of upper airway obstruction or edema that could be causing that. Hemoptysis is one thing that we all dread when patients present with. We are really worried whether the patient is going to have severe hemoptysis or not, whether we can contain the hemoptysis or not. And all the lists that you can see here, which starts all the way from neoplasm to vascular to infections to vasculitis, sometimes it is very difficult to find a cause, but all you want is a fair protected airway. So what can a bronchoscope do? The first teaching that my teachers taught me when I was studying was, do not do a bronchoscopy in an actively bleeding hemoptysis. And that is something you must take back from here. A bronchoscopy is very good, very helpful in a patient who is having hemoptysis and has compromised airways. But in an actively bleeding patient, if they are hemodynamically stable, the best thing to do is a CT scan, find out the side of bleeding and make them lie down on that side, down. That's the best thing to do. But if they have a compromised airway, then you can put the tube down, you can suction out and clear the airways, and that's where the bronchoscope helps you. And when the patient stabilizes, you can then put your bronchoscope down and find the cause of hemoptysis. And that's how it can help. Sometimes when it's an endobronchial cause, like I'm referred a lot of patients with advanced malignancies who have a central tumor and they are bleeding, there what we can do is where we find the cause of bronchiectasis, we can put in the bronchoscope there. Sometimes we can do adrenaline suction, adrenaline instillation. We can put in some more fibrin glue if we find there is a tumor there. We can even do laser or argon plasma for stopping the bleeding, but that is only for central lesions of hemoptysis, central causes of hemoptysis. For peripheral causes, you can't do that. So in those cases, you can only free up the central airway and treat them conservatively. That's all that the bronchoscope helps in an acute hemoptysis. Fibrin glue therapy with a bronchoscope in an intubated patient is sometimes used. In our hospital, we have a very good thoracic surgery team, and when we have ongoing leak, ongoing bronchopleural fistula, we are called in as pulmonologists to go down, have a look inside and find if there is an area that is leaking, if a stump is leaking. For example, this is one patient that we had who had, after a lobectomy, continued to ooze from one segment alone. So the bronchoscope, we took it down and we found there was air bubbling from there. So we put in, what did we do? We took some fibrin glue in and we put it there and left it there. And that sometimes, if the leak is small, it just seals it. And it saves the patient going in for a major surgery a second time. And it can be useful. This is just to keep in mind in case you have a patient and that you need to deal with. Coming on to atelectasis, this is very important and a very important cause of bronchoscopy in the ICU. But do all atelectasis need bronchoscopy? So there was this study that came out which said not all acute lobar atelectasis actually need chest physiotherapy, mucolytics in small atelectasis are as good as going in and doing aggressive bronchoscopy. And therefore, the overall success rate varies from 19 to 89% depending on when you're doing it or who you're doing it for. Therefore, finding out which ones needed, these are the indications for fiber optic bronchoscopy in an ICU patient with atelectasis. So it should be life-threatening, acute whole lung or near whole lung atelectasis. A lobar atelectasis with radiological finding of bronchogram extending to the segmental bronchi. Atelectasis is failing to improve with positioning and suctioning and or chest physiotherapy. Neuromuscular disease patients who are not going to be able to cough up, where even if you do physiotherapy, they don't have a good enough cough reflex, there you have to do cleaning. In patients with cystic fibrosis and those who are not feasible for chest physiotherapy. This is one of our patients. This is from 2010. The patient came in and had a pneumonia on the left side, and then within the next 3 days suddenly dropped their saturations and were not ventilating well at all, with a whole white out of the left lung. And lo and behold, these are very satisfying to do. You go and find one big mucus plug completely blocking the main bronchus. So what do? You go in and do a hoovering job and clean it out. And this is very, very satisfactory. Sometimes we get patients like this after a chest trauma or after surgery. They come with, as you can see, a lot of subcutaneous emphysema, but nothing else. And you have a CT scan here, which shows that just outside the trachea, there is some air. So there's definite tracheal injury. To confirm definite tracheal injury, you can use your bronchoscope to see whether there are lacerations, etc., there or not. And that helps your surgeon to take care of it. And you can stabilize these patients even before the surgeon goes in. So those were the indications, but we must know what are the contraindications of patients to do bronchoscopy. Experience is bottom line. Inexperienced bronchoscopists should not go in because they might worsen your patient's hemodynamics more than you would like them to improve. Inability to adequately oxygenate and ventilate the patient is another one. Acute MI or unstable coronary heart disease is another contraindication. Worsening asthma, severe pulmonary hypertension, and severe cardiovascular instability and uncooperative patients are the other contraindications. And these need to be explained before you go in today's days of litigation. Complications, it's a very, very, very safe process, and the complication rate is less than 4% even in the worst of patients. So please remain very calm while doing the procedure. And the common complications that you come across are hypoxemia, arrhythmia, which is usually as a result of hypoxemia, related to pre-medication and topical anesthesia and sedation. In a lot of these patients, we might not sedate them at all. Fever and pneumonia is very common. Fever post-bronchoscopy is very common. Hemorrhage, unlikely, unusual. And pneumothorax only if you are doing a transbronchial lung biopsy. Otherwise, pneumothorax is not very common. So the procedure is very simple. So we say that use absolute infection control measures before doing the procedure. Do it in a very aseptic way. Give adequate antibiotic prophylaxis if required. And make sure that the patient has not eaten for 4 hours beforehand. They have not been given any Ryle's tube feeding 4 hours beforehand, because there's increased chances of aspiration pneumonia if you don't do that. And everything else, make sure they are not in type 2 respiratory failure or in severe type 1 respiratory failure, and that the endotracheal tube is at least 2 millimeters bigger than the size of the bronchoscope you are going to use. That is of paramount importance. And do not stay in and out for too long. Don't use it for too long. Do not underventilate your patient for too long is very important. So nowadays, swivel adapters are available, which help you protect the patient's ventilation and tidal volume while you're doing the procedure. And make sure you put your saturations, oxygen levels up to 100%, oxygen, pre-oxygenate the patient before doing the process. Use suction processes very, as little as possible, as short as possible, multiple times if required. And before I finish, I just want to show you one procedure, which is EBUS. I'll just take 2 minutes. And that is endobronchial ultrasound, which is nothing but a bronchoscope with an ultrasound attached at the end. And how is this useful in a case? It's nothing but a bronchoscope attached with an ultrasound at the end. And so what do we see with it? We see the mediastinal structures, but along with it, we can also see the aortic arch, the pulmonary arteries, azygous veins, and the hilar vessels. And it is sometimes extremely useful when you are suspecting a disease like pulmonary embolism, because some of these patients are so sick that you can't take them for CTPA, or their creatinine is too high and you can't take them for CTPA. What do you do when you're suspecting it? So what these patients, if they have a central pulmonary embolism, sometimes an EBUS is extremely helpful. And how is that helpful? I'll show you in this case of a 60-year-old gentleman who came with acute and chronic shortness of breath on exertion. Clinically, his D-dimers were high, and he had a clinically high suspicion of pulmonary embolism. CT angiogram, as you can see, was unclear whether this was a tumor or a pulmonary embolus, as you can see here. So what did we do? We put our pulmonary, we put our EBUS probe into the endotracheal tube, and as you can see, the pulmonary artery was filled with a big embolus. And this actually helped us diagnose confidently and treat it. Therefore, these are advances that are going to happen and be used more and more often. And therefore, in conclusion, what I'd like to say is that it is a very useful diagnostic and therapeutic tool. It must be done by experienced bronchoscopists, and the yield from a properly dulled bowel can aid clear diagnosis and management. And the extended scope of bronchoscopy in EBUS is emerging in pulmonary embolism and is pretty useful. Thank you very much.